Chapter 10 Basic Flight Maneuvers Introduction. This chapter provides information to help the instructor explain and demonstrate basic flight maneuvers to students. Since instructors often forget the difficulties they encountered in mastering various flight maneuvers, this chapter is designed as a teaching aid to refresh the instructor's memory of the difficulties involved in learning various helicopter maneuvers. Basic maneuvers. Basic flight maneuvers consist of five fundamental modes of flight: straight and level, turns, climbs, descents, and hovering. A student should understand that all maneuvers are based on one or a combination of these fundamental modes. Inform the student that the practical test standards, PTS, establish the minimum standards or acceptable limits for the performance of each maneuver. Prior to flight, a briefing should be conducted that includes the training to be accomplished, crew responsibilities in the event of an emergency, and the procedure for the exchange of flight controls. A positive three-step process in the exchange of flight controls between pilots is a proven procedure and one that is strongly recommended. Note, beginning with hover training as the first helicopter maneuver may be unwise. The student has not had the opportunity to learn how the helicopter reacts to control inputs. Learning control inputs for the first time 3 feet above the ground is unsettling for most. One option is for the instructor to take the student up to altitude and allow that student to become comfortable with the helicopter flight controls. Once the student is comfortable with the flight controls, proceed to lower and slower flight until hovering is finally achieved. Straight and level flight. It is important that the student be able to maintain a constant heading, altitude, and airspeed. Explain and demonstrate that straight and level flight is actually a series of small corrections needed to maintain the original attitude and heading following natural deviations caused by inadvertent control inputs or turbulence. The attitude required to maintain straight and level flight should be clearly defined using all available visual aids. One aid is the distance between the horizon and the tip path plane of the rotor system. Figure 10.1, roll attitude can be determined by using the tip path plane or a canopy crossbar and its relation to the natural horizon. Prominent objects on the ground should be used for heading reference. This encourages the student to look outside instead of concentrating too much on the instruments. While the student is gaining proficiency in straight and level flight, power is usually not adjusted once it is set, in order to maintain the desired cruise power. Instructional points. It is important that the student learn to recognize the correct attitude for various flight maneuvers. The attitude of the helicopter usually indicates the rate of acceleration or deceleration of the helicopter and the airspeed, and is controlled by the cyclic. Altitude is primarily controlled by the use of the collective. To maintain forward flight, the rotor tip path plane must be tilted forward to obtain the necessary horizontal thrust component from the main rotor. This usually results in an initially nose-low attitude. Due to the horizontal stabilizer, once the helicopter stabilizes in flight, the helicopter's fuselage will tend to return to a neutral, level attitude. The attitude of the helicopter should not be confused with the position of the rotor disc relative to the horizon. The lower the nose rotor disc is, the greater the power is that is required to maintain altitude, and the higher the resulting airspeeds. Conversely, the greater the power used, the lower the rotor disc must be to maintain at altitude. Since the helicopter is suspended beneath the rotor system, the angle of attack of the wings is not determined by the airframe's pitch as in an airplane. The horizontal stabilizer streamlines the helicopter airframe for reduced drag by applying more downforce as airspeed increases, thereby raising the nose to a level or almost level cruising attitude. Show the student, while in straight and level flight, any increase in the collective also increases the airspeed and altitude, due to an increase in lift and thrust. A decrease in the collective while holding airspeed constant causes a helicopter to descend. A change in the collective requires a coordinated change of the throttle to maintain a constant RPM. In this handbook, all throttle discussions refer to helicopters without a governor or correlator. Additionally, the anti-torque pedals need to be adjusted to maintain heading and keep the helicopter in longitudinal trim. To increase airspeed in straight and level flight, instruct the student to apply forward pressure on the cyclic and raise the collective as necessary to maintain altitude. To decrease airspeed, the student needs to apply rearward pressure on the cyclic and lower the collective as necessary to maintain altitude. The student should be guided to notice the yawing resulting from the changing of the torque and airflows over the vertical stabilizer as equipped, and make sufficient changes to maintain the heading and trim. Once the student has maintained a specific altitude and airspeed with little deviation, point out that the helicopter's altitude and airspeed remain constant with a constant power setting. Small adjustments may be required to compensate for turbulence, but ensure the student uses outside references and does not focus on instruments alone. Assess the position of the rotor disc relative to the natural horizon. The attitude of the helicopter due to the influence of the horizontal stabilizer will approximate a consistent level attitude when not accelerating or decelerating. Also, Heading is easier to maintain if the student at some point looks outside in line with the intended flight path. Looking outside fulfills another very important task, scanning for other traffic and obstructions. To prevent overcontrolling, teach control pressures and not movements. This is especially true in the first few lessons when the student is concentrating on control input and how the helicopter reacts. Common student difficulties visualizing attitude, the forward seating position, and the excellent visibility in most helicopters may make it difficult for a student to visualize the attitude of the helicopter. It is important that the instructor provide all the assistance possible to ensure the student can determine an attitude by some visual reference. Instructors usually develop different methods of teaching attitude references. Overcontrolling. Two factors contribute to overcontrolling the helicopter, the most common difficulty for the beginning student. First, the student fails to notice attitude deviation until it becomes rather large. Second, in the attempt to recover to level attitude, too much control is applied because a student is not prepared for the helicopter's quick response to control inputs. Generally, the beginning student does not know when to remove a control input and usually holds it until after the required attitude has passed. This results in an overshoot, followed by another large control application, another overshoot, and so on. Explain that controls are operated by pressure rather than movement, and it is not necessary to return immediately to the level attitude. As soon as the student understands these two items and loses the sense of urgency, overcontrolling diminishes. It is also helpful to remind a student that when a deviation from the desired attitude is noticed, the proper technique is to first stop the deviation, then make a smooth correction to return to the original attitude. Trim. To reduce control pressures in helicopters with electric trim, it is imperative to have the helicopter properly trimmed before the student takes control, otherwise the term control pressure is meaningless. When the helicopter is out of trim, some control pressure must be held just to maintain the desired attitude, and any instruction to relax control pressure can only lead to confusion. If the helicopter has an electric trim, especially the coolie hat type, the student should be shown how it functions before starting the engine and turning the blades. If installed, have the student use the trim and remind him or her to always trim the pressures off. The on/off type, force trim, is often of less value and very often just left off by experienced pilots as a personal preference. When trim is mentioned in this handbook, it is in reference to the anti-torque trim of the helicopter unless otherwise indicated. Coordination. Most beginning students have difficulty relating the effect one control has on another. The most obvious of these is the change in torque as power is changed, requiring the use of anti-torque pedal pressure as power is varied. Less obvious is the effect of a power change on pitch attitude in forward flight due to gyroscopic precession and differential lift on the advancing and retreating blades. As power is increased with the collective, the nose tends to pitch up. As power is decreased, the nose pitches down. As speed is increased, the nose of the helicopter tends to rise and begin a roll towards the retreating blade. These effects can be most disconcerting to the student unless the instructor thoroughly explains and demonstrates them. Scan. To correct a deviation, it must first be recognized. Most beginning students tend to devote all of their attention to a specific problem. For example, full attention may be devoted to an altitude problem while the helicopter drifts off heading or the airspeed changes. Students may also fail to see other aircraft or obstacles in the vicinity if their attention is fixed on a single item. Some instructors find it helpful to call out or point to the items that should be included in the scan pattern. This helps the student build a good habitual scan. It is important that the student be taught to include the engine instruments in the scan, so an impending engine problem does not go undetected. Kinesthesia. The sense of motion and pressure changes through nerve endings and muscular sensations is scientifically named kinesthesia, but is commonly called seat of the pants flying. This sense can be developed more rapidly if the instructor calls attention to the sensations as they occur. Development of this sense enables a student to become aware of changes in the helicopter's attitude more quickly. Point out to the student the importance of the other senses as well. The sounds of the engine, rotor, and transmission give information of RPM and possible mechanical problems. Seeing, vision allows us to fly safely, maintaining level flight with the horizon and slash or the instruments. Unusual smells while in flight may be indications of something getting hot or burning within the helicopter. Touch may be the pressure counter pressure that we exert on the anti-torque pedals or the amount of cyclic input to maintain flight profiles. Normal climb. The objectives in practicing climbs are to achieve proficiency in establishing a climb attitude and airspeed, setting climb power while maintaining a specified RPM, and coordinating the use of flight controls. Proficiency is also gained by understanding the techniques used in leveling off at a designated altitude and establishing level cruise flight. Instructional points for both climbs and descents, focus on 1. Transitioning from one power setting to another, cruise power to climb power, then back to cruise power, for the descent, cruise power to approach power, then back to cruise power, if desired. 2. Coordinating the controls as a result of a power change. 3. Clearing the helicopter above or below prior to initiating a climb or descent. To enter a constant airspeed climb from cruise airspeed, simultaneously increase the collective and throttle RPM to obtain climb power. Adjust anti-torque pedals to maintain helicopter in yaw trim. Note, in a counterclockwise rotor system, a left pedal input is required for an increase in torque, right pedal for a torque decrease. An increase in power causes the helicopter to start climbing, and only slight back pressure on the cyclic is required to change from a level to a climb attitude. Note, discuss with the student how helicopter design affects climb and descent attitudes. For example, some helicopters are designed to increase the usable CG range of the helicopter at higher airspeeds. Nose high or nose low attitudes are also based on load conditions or aircraft designs. Therefore, climb attitude is slightly different from one helicopter design to the other. Point out to the student that simply pulling aft cyclic, while in cruise flight, initiates a climb and, in a short period of time, airspeed lowers and a descent begins. If the available lift/thrust is completely converted to vertical lift by using aft cyclic, the helicopter will begin descending when it slows enough to lose translational lift. This is not the coordinated climb that you are attempting to achieve. While in cruise flight, forward cyclic initiates a descent and, in a short period of time, your airspeed increases. However, depending on altitude, this could result in retreating blade stall. These types of maneuvers are discouraged during training so the student can learn to control the helicopter within stated parameters. This results in a better trained pilot with better skills. As the airspeed approaches normal climb airspeed, adjust the cyclic to hold this airspeed. Throughout the maneuver, maintain climb attitude, heading, and airspeed with the cyclic, climb power and RPM with the collective and throttle, and yaw trim with the anti-torque pedals. To level off from a climb, start adjusting the attitude to the level flight attitude a few feet prior to reaching the desired altitude. The amount of lead depends on the rate of climb at the time of level off. The higher the rate of climb, the more the lead. Generally, the lead is 10% of the climb rate. For example, if your climb rate is 500 feet per minute, you should lead the level off by 50 feet. To begin the level off, adjust cyclic to adjust and maintain a cruise flight attitude. You should maintain climb power until the airspeed approaches the desired cruising airspeed, then lower the collective to obtain cruising power and adjust the throttle to obtain and maintain cruising RPM. Throughout the level off, maintain yaw trim and heading with the anti-torque pedals. The instructor should remind the student of the effects of inertia, which require some lead time and efforts. Just as one applies the brakes in a car before a stop sign, a pilot should apply control inputs prior to the desired point, be that an altitude or heading. Common student difficulties attitude is in straight and level flight. Students frequently have difficulty visualizing and establishing the proper attitude for the climb. Use whatever references are available in the helicopter, such as the tip path plane, canopy crossbars, or any other structural reference. Depending on the helicopter, horizontal stabilizer, and rate of change in altitude, the climb attitude may be the same as the cruise attitude, or slightly higher. Over-controlling the difficulty in establishing the correct climb airspeed may be the result of over-controlling. Since establishing the correct airspeed is usually accomplished by a series of pitch attitude adjustments, students may not hold the attitude long enough for the airspeed to stabilize. This leads to excessive maneuvering while chasing the airspeed. At this point, frustration and tension begin to build. When it becomes apparent that the student is getting frustrated, the instructor can try one of the following three things: have the student return to straight and level flight, take over for a brief demonstration while the student relaxes, or allow the student to continue climbing until they achieve a stabilized climb and perceive the sight picture and control pressures. If climbing to an altitude is too complicated, just strive for a coordinated climb at first. Instructors should never be afraid to break any maneuver down to its component parts and allow the student to practice those individual skills until they are ready to assemble those skills into a complete maneuver. Coordination in the process of beginning a climb, all controls are utilized. Each control input causes something else to change, and a beginning student may have difficulty, not only in accomplishing the actions in the proper sequence, but also in compensating for control inputs. During the level off, some students have a tendency to decrease power before adjusting attitude, cyclic, for cruise flight. Talk the student through the maneuver to remove any doubt about what is to be accomplished, as well as how and when it is done. Scan the scan pattern mentioned in straight and level flight becomes more important when the flight condition is constantly changing. Several things are happening at once and the task becomes more difficult unless the student has rehearsed the actions and reactions of the helicopter. Normal descent. A normal descent is a maneuver in which the helicopter loses altitude at a controlled rate in a controlled attitude. The objective in practicing descents is to gain proficiency in establishing the attitude necessary to maintain the desired airspeed, setting power as required to maintain the desired rate of descent while maintaining a constant rotor RPM and correcting for changing torque. Instructional points to establish a normal descent from straight and level flight at cruising airspeed: lower the collective to obtain proper power, adjust the throttle to maintain RPM, a slight amount of cyclic adjustment is normally necessary to maintain desired airspeed, and adjust anti-torque pedals to maintain heading. Throughout the maneuver, maintain descending attitude and airspeed with the cyclic, descending power and RPM with the collective and throttle, and yaw trim with the anti-torque pedals. To level off from the descent, lead the desired altitude by approximately 10% of the rate of descent. For example, a descent rate of 500 feet per minute would require a 50-foot lead. At this point, increase the collective to obtain cruising power, adjust the throttle to maintain RPM, adjust anti-torque pedals to maintain yaw trim, and adjust the cyclic to obtain cruising airspeed and a level flight attitude. Common student difficulties: attitude visualization of pitch attitude may be difficult for the student in the initial stages of flight training. Make use of any available reference points on the helicopter in order to maintain some sort of visual reference. Helicopter attitude is primary for acceleration and deceleration control. The airspeed indicator is going to be the primary indicator for airspeed control. If the airspeed is slow, then the nose must be lowered to accelerate the helicopter until the airspeed increases. As the airspeed increases, the pilot must plan on indicator delays and allow the helicopter attitude to stabilize and neutralize equilibrium at the desired airspeed. The descent attitude may be the same as the level attitude was once the helicopter is stabilized in the descent. Coordination: the student may have difficulty adjusting throttle and anti-torque pedals while simultaneously adjusting the collective to set descent power. Emphasize that power is to be changed slowly and smoothly to minimize coordination problems. Scan: it is common for a student to concentrate on one factor to the exclusion of others. Students have difficulty with two areas in this maneuver: maintaining a constant angle of descent and leading the level off sufficiently. These two problems often result in recovery below the desired altitude. Turns are practiced to develop skill in establishing and maintaining a desired angle of bank, while holding the pitch attitude that is appropriate to the desired maneuver. Level turns are practiced first, using bank angles of approximately 15 to 20 degrees. Figure 10-2, as the student is developing his or her skills, turns should be practiced at different airspeeds. As the student progresses, turns at VH or VNE should be added to the program, as well as turns below effective translational lift. Care should be exercised to avoid LTE at low altitudes. If possible, a demonstration of LTE at higher altitudes is a good teaching point for the new student. Instructional points: before making any turns, make sure the student clears the area in the direction of the turn, as well as above and below the helicopter. To enter a turn from straight and level flight, apply sideward pressure on the cyclic in the direction the turn is to be made. This is the only control movement needed to start the turn. Anti-torque pedals are not used to assist the turn. Airplane pilots transitioning to helicopters attempt to use the anti-torque pedals as they would a rudder pedal. Use the pedals only to compensate for torque to keep the helicopter in yaw trim. How fast the helicopter banks depends on how much lateral cyclic pressure is applied. How far the helicopter banks, the steepness of the bank, depends on how long the cyclic is displaced. After establishing the proper bank angle, return the cyclic toward the neutral position. Explain to the student that the cyclic tilts the rotor disc relative to the horizon. The amount of tilt or bank depends on how much and how long the cyclic is displaced from perpendicular to the horizon. The rotor disc always follows the cyclic. As the pilot places the cyclic in a neutral position in relation to the helicopter, the cyclic is simply maintaining the rotor disc tilt as reference to the horizon and the helicopter follows the rotor. Returning the cyclic to the neutral position simply stops the bank, rotor tilt, from increasing or decreasing. Use the collective and throttle to maintain altitude and RPM. As the torque increases, apply more pressure to the proper anti-torque pedal to maintain longitudinal trim. Depending on the degree of bank, additional forward cyclic pressure may be required to maintain airspeed. When rolling out of a turn, the cyclic is moved back to perpendicular to the horizon, which brings the rotor back to level with the horizon. Lead or lag on the rollout is necessary to complete the maneuver on the desired heading. Common student difficulties: attitude visualization of the bank angle is one of the most common problems for students. The angle between the tip path plane and the horizon should always remain stable and consistent when banking or turning the helicopter. As the bank angle is established and the perspective changes, there is a tendency to use the center of the canopy as the pitch reference. It must be emphasized that the correct pitch reference is directly in front of the student. The pitch reference point should remain stationary as the helicopter is rolled into the bank, with the helicopter appearing to pivot around the pitch reference. The correct pitch attitude is confirmed by reference to the altimeter and a level turn. If the student attempts to maintain altitude solely by reference to the altimeter, over-controlling usually results and the student begins chasing the altitude. Leaning away from a turn, there is a natural tendency to keep the body, or at least the head, level. When the student leans away from the turn, perspective changes, making it even more difficult to maintain the correct attitude. Failure to clear the area. The student is frequently so occupied with the problems associated with maintaining altitude, airspeed, bank angle, etc., that the responsibility of seeing and avoiding other aircraft is neglected. Clearing the area and the direction of the turn must be included in the items the instructor calls out while talking the student through the maneuver. Stress to the student that clearing of the helicopter is continuous. Other traffic occupies the same airspace, such as traffic helicopters, crop dusters, rescue, police, power line patrols, and many others. If operating near military training areas, remind the student of low-level VFR and IFR routes and the increase in flight activity. Birds or anything above ground level, towers, power lines, etc., present flight hazards as well. Rolling out of a turn. Difficulties associated with rolling out of a turn are usually related to scan problems. The student who is preoccupied with other factors often loses track of heading. Select a prominent landmark and instruct a student to anticipate the rollout by an amount equal to about half the bank angle. Climbing and descending turns. Climbing and descending turns are used to further develop control and coordination. They also provide the practice required for departures and landing approaches. Instructional points. As always, before making any turns, clear the helicopter in the direction of the turn, as well as above and below the helicopter. The turn and climb/descent are usually initiated simultaneously. Until the student gains proficiency, it may be easier first to establish each maneuver separately. For example, to enter a climbing/descending turn, establish the turn first, then adjust the controls for the climb/descent. You may reverse the order as well. With enough practice, the student will learn to simultaneously perform the required control inputs to accomplish a climbing/descending turn. Common student difficulties. Attitude. Combining turns with climbs/descents introduces new helicopter attitudes, and the initial perception of these attitudes may be difficult for the student to comprehend. A thorough briefing and demonstration minimizes this problem. The first climbing/descending turns should be established by beginning the climb/descent and then rolling into the desired bank angle in order to reduce the number of simultaneous control movements required. Scan. As with the previous maneuvers, the scan pattern is easily interrupted by concentrating on a specific aspect of the maneuver. During early practice of climbing/descending turns, the instructor should call out all the items that require attention, even if no correction is required. As proficiency improves, the instructor should call attention only to the items that require corrective action. Coordination exercises. Once level flight, turns, climbs, and descents have been introduced, coordination exercises should be practiced to assist a student in developing subconscious coordinated control and proficiency. A good exercise to teach compensation for power changes is to make airspeed changes while maintaining straight and level flight. At a safe altitude, and while maintaining a constant RPM, altitude, and heading, have the student reduce airspeed to 40 knots by simultaneously applying F-cyclic and reducing power. Now, instruct the student to accelerate to approximately 80 knots by increasing forward cyclic and power. The maneuver may be repeated, as necessary, for proficiency. During these maneuvers, allowing a stable flight for a few moments and pointing out the helicopter's attitude at the different airspeeds will help the student become familiar with that particular helicopter's attitude set by the horizontal stabilizer for those airspeeds and loads. There may be an 11% change in the weight of some helicopters when the instructor deboards for the student's first solo flight, and a considerable sight picture change with that much weight out of one side of the helicopter. Another exercise that develops smoothness and coordination is rolling from a medium bank to the left into a medium bank to the right, then back to the left, and continuing the series while maintaining a constant base heading and altitude. Each of these exercises helps develop smoothness, coordination, and an active scan pattern. If a student is having trouble coordinating RPM and manifold pressure, an exercise in throttle/collective coordination can be used. Have the student maintain a constant attitude while disregarding altitude. Now, instruct the student to change the manifold pressure with the collective while holding a constant RPM with the throttle. Then, reverse the procedure by having the student change the RPM with the throttle while maintaining a constant manifold pressure with the collective. This exercise allows the student to concentrate on throttle/collective coordination without devoting attention to other factors. Approaches. An approach is defined as the transition from traffic pattern altitude to either a hover or to the surface. In day-to-day operations, approaches in a helicopter may be dictated more by existing conditions than by formal patterns. For training, however, a formal pattern is used to give the student a basis upon which to build the modified patterns a particular situation may require. Downwind, base, and final approach legs should be flown in accordance with the patterns the instructor outlines. A normal approach uses a descent profile of 8 degrees minus 12 degrees starting at approximately 300 feet AGL. Figure 10.3, the rectangular pattern explained on page 10.20 serves as a good basis for helicopter traffic pattern with the downwind at 500 feet AGL or higher as needed for noise, traffic and aircraft characteristics. Emphasize to the student that aligning with the landing direction may allow the pilot to detect wind sooner and detect obstructions. Flying any path that is less than straight into an area on the approach azimuth decreases the time available for hazard detection and low reconnaissance. Instructional points for the beginning student: each approach should be started at approximately the same position and at the same airspeed and altitude. This allows a consistent basis for the student and instructor to evaluate each approach. To accomplish this, concentrate on each leg of the traffic pattern so the helicopter arrives at the point the approach is started and at the correct position, speed, and altitude. As the approach angle comes into view, begin the approach by lowering the collective sufficiently to get the helicopter descending down the approach angle. The approach angle should be an imaginary angle from the landing gear to the landing point, and not from the pilot's eyes to the landing point. With a decrease in the collective, the nose tends to pitch down, requiring aft cyclic to maintain the recommended approach airspeed attitude. Adjust anti-torque pedal as necessary to maintain yaw trim. Maintain entry airspeed until the apparent ground speed and rate of closure appear to be increasing. At this point, slowly begin decelerating with slight aft cyclic, and smoothly lower the collective to maintain approach angle. Use the cyclic to maintain an apparent rate of closure equivalent to a brisk walk. Explain to the student that a helicopter pilot should plan an approach to keep the skid/landing gear at a constant angle to a 3-foot hover over the intended landing area. Keeping the landing area in one spot in the windshield or bubble does not result in a good approach for a helicopter pilot. It is best for the pilot to visualize and fly the skid/landing gear down the approach angle to the hover point. At approximately 25 to 40 feet AGL, depending on wind, the helicopter begins to lose effective translational lift. To compensate for this loss, increase the collective to maintain the approach angle, while maintaining the proper RPM. The increase of collective pitch tends to make the nose rise, requiring forward cyclic to maintain the proper rate of closure. On short final, this is also when the airflow in the aft portion of the rotor disc is disturbed, so the increased pitch in the forward portion of the disc is not balanced by the same lift in the aft portion. Depending on the amount of deceleration used, forward cyclic may be needed to maintain the hovering position. As the helicopter approaches the recommended hover altitude, increase the collective sufficiently to maintain the hover. At the same time, apply aft cyclic to stop any forward movement, while controlling the heading with anti-torque pedals. Common student difficulties: ground track. There can be no basis upon which to build unless the approach path is consistent. Therefore, the student must start the pattern from the same indicated airspeed, altitude, and distance from the landing spot. Thereafter, the student should be encouraged to maintain the correct pattern so each approach does not present a new set of circumstances. During initial training, explain to the student how different wind conditions can affect the helicopter and teach them how to adjust the flight controls so that they are always flying the helicopter rather than letting the helicopter take control of them. As the student gains experience, the instructor should have the student brief the effects of the winds on the expected flight maneuvers and what actions must be taken by the student to counteract those effects. Altitude. The same comments concerning ground track are applicable to altitudes on downwind base and the turn to final approach. Changing altitude requires modifications in some other parameter, resulting in a different approach pattern. Therefore, turns to each leg of the approach should be made from the same spot and at the same altitude during a single training period. Airspeed control is important if the student is to establish and maintain a consistent approach. Thus, it is important for the student to be aware of and adhere to recommended approach airspeeds. Approach angle. The student must understand the reason for utilizing a standard approach path. It is to establish the final approach leg at a distance and altitude that requires the same angle to the landing spot on each approach. In this manner, the student learns to visualize the correct approach angle, making it easier to learn the techniques for making corrections. If there is a visual approach slope indicator, VASI, of some type near, it is good to have the student look up the VASI's glide slope angle and then fly to the VASI. It is often helpful for the instructor to fly while the student observes how the stated angle appears. because VASIs are often near 3 degrees, about 3 times that angle, 9 degrees, can be a normal helicopter approach angle. The instructor will then announce when the VASI angle is doubled and finally begin the descent when triple the VASI angle. This allows the student to have a gauge or standard for the normal approach angle. Traffic with all the other factors requiring the student's attention, it is very easy to relax vigilance for other aircraft. Before turning to base leg, the student should be required to check for approaching traffic and state whether the pattern is clear of conflicting traffic. Then on final approach, the area should be checked in all directions to make sure there are no other aircraft on, or about to turn onto, the final approach leg. Power adjustments during the approach, the power setting is usually quite low. In a hover, it is quite high. Most beginning students wait until they are very close to the ground before adding power. This can easily lead to over-controlling. This is usually done while transitioning through translational lift. The instructor should remind the student that, as power is added by increasing the collective, the cyclic must be used to ensure the extra power is all directed to replace the lift lost as translational lift is lost. This is done by adjusting the cyclic aft in most conditions. As this is happening, the student will also correct for yaw from the loss of translational thrust and place the helicopter in a slip to align the landing gear with the ground track. This habit is important when a landing to the surface begins. When power is added, the attitude must be changed to continue moving forward and down to the intended landing spot. Forward cycle may be needed because too much deceleration will excessively slow the rate of closure. While paying attention to airspeed and the height/velocity diagram, it may be necessary to slow the helicopter more than usual in the beginning phases of training so the student understands, and is comfortable with, the transition from the approach to the hover. Go around before solo, a student must be taught the procedures and techniques used in a go around. Encourage the student to use the go around procedure as a safety precaution at any time he or she is uncomfortable with continuing the approach. Go around should be taught early and often. Every student should know that go arounds are good maneuvers for the best pilots. If in doubt, go around. Students should learn to abort landings when the circumstances feel uncomfortable. Instructional points: a go-around is initiated by adding power to the climb power setting and accelerating to climb speed. When power is added, two common errors may occur. One, with the initial power change, the rate of descent may stop, and the student may not add enough power to continue a climb, they level off. Two, when power is added, the nose of the helicopter begins to rise, giving the impression that the helicopter is climbing. This results in a loss of airspeed if no forward cyclic is added. If allowed to continue, the helicopter may begin to settle. When the decision to initiate a go-around is made, carry it out without hesitation. Common student difficulties initiating the go-around: even experienced pilots may be hesitant to initiate a go-around, either from failure to recognize the need for one or as a matter of pride. Teach the student to recognize the need for a go-around early in the approach instead of waiting until the last moment. The safety of the aircraft and its occupants is the first consideration, and a go-around should be executed at the first indication of an unsatisfactory approach or any unsafe conditions on the intended landing point. Also discuss with the student the difference in helicopter reactions, power requirements, while performing go-arounds above and below ETL. Coordination: many things must be accomplished simultaneously as a go-around is initiated. Collective is increased, RPM is adjusted as necessary, anti-torque pedal corrections are made, and the attitude is adjusted to first accelerate to climb speed and then to maintain it. In the process, the student might overlook one or more of the required adjustments. It may help to practice the first few go-arounds at higher altitudes so the proximity to the ground is not a distracting factor. Normal and crosswind takeoff from a hover: the normal takeoff from a hover is the transition from hovering flight into a climb over a specified ground track. During the climb, airspeed and altitude should be such that the crosshatched or shaded areas of the height/velocity diagram are avoided. Other types of takeoff may be performed, however, the student needs to learn early how and why he or she is performing a specific takeoff. The pilot should be making a risk assessment to determine which type of takeoff is the safest. Instructional points: discuss with the student during the pre-flight what control inputs are required during hovering flight and takeoffs. There is more to a normal takeoff than just adding forward cyclic. Bring the helicopter to a hover and make a performance check, which includes power balance and flight controls. The power check should include an evaluation of the amount of excess power available. The balance condition of the helicopter is indicated by the position of the cyclic when maintaining a stationary hover. Wind may necessitate some cyclic deflection, but there should not be an extreme deviation from neutral. Flight controls must move freely, and a helicopter should respond normally. Visually clear the area all around and above. start the helicopter moving by smoothly and slowly easing the cyclic forward. As the helicopter starts to move forward, increase the collective as necessary to prevent the helicopter from sinking and adjust the throttle to maintain RPM. The sink is caused by diverting lift into forward thrust. Discuss with the student the aerodynamic effects of the rotor system during hovering flight and during normal takeoff. The increase in power requires an increase in the proper anti-torque pedal to maintain heading. Emphasis should be placed on aligning landing gear precisely with the direction of travel to avoid dynamic rollover should the student allow the helicopter to touch the surface during takeoff. Select ground reference points to maintain a straight takeoff path throughout the takeoff. Ensure the student chooses several ground reference points during the maneuver to maintain a ground track. As the forward portion of the rotor system gains undisturbed air, the lift on the forward portion of the rotor tends to lift the front of the disc and stops the acceleration. A little forward cyclic to maintain the accelerating attitude is necessary to continue the takeoff. As the aft portion of the rotor system gains undisturbed air, the nose tends to tilt forward, causing an excessively fast acceleration. At about the same time, translational lift becomes apparent and some forward cyclic motion is required to gain sufficient airspeed to avoid the HV chart shaded areas, while continuing a safe climb avoiding the shaded areas. As airspeed increases, the streamlining of the fuselage reduces engine torque effect, requiring a gradual reduction of anti-torque pedal pressure. Just as translational lift occurs, translational thrust follows. This gives two effects that must be countered by adjusting the pedals as the climb begins. As the helicopter continues to climb and accelerate to best rate of climb, apply aft cyclic pressure to raise the nose smoothly to the normal attitude. Ensure that the student understands that he or she must make constant corrections during all phases of flight. This is to compensate for actions and reactions. Crosswind considerations during takeoffs. When the takeoff is made during crosswind conditions, the helicopter is flown in a slip during early stages of the maneuver. In this case, the cyclic is held into the wind a sufficient amount to maintain the desired ground track for the takeoff. The heading is maintained with the use of the anti-torque pedals. In other words, the rotor is tilted into the wind so the sideward movement of the helicopter is just enough to counteract the crosswind effect. To prevent the nose from turning in the direction of the rotor tilt, it is necessary to increase the anti-torque pedal pressure on the side opposite the rotor tilt. After approximately 50 feet of altitude is gained, crab the helicopter into the wind as necessary to maintain coordinated flight over the desired ground track. The stronger the crosswind, the more the helicopter has to be turned into the wind. Common student difficulties. Attitude control is in most other maneuvers smooth. Positive attitude control is the key to success in the takeoff. If the student is properly briefed and understands the changing forces during takeoff, it is possible to anticipate and correct deviations promptly. At about 5 knots, ground effect diminishes and a helicopter begins to sink. Depending on available power and instructor technique, power should be added to prevent this sink. Any power change requires an anti-torque pedal adjustment, which in turn requires a cyclic adjustment to accommodate the increased translating tendency. If the student does not make these adjustments, the ground track will not be straight. Shortly after forward movement is initiated, translational lift is encountered and the nose pitches. This requires forward cyclic to keep the helicopter accelerating. Heading control. Pedal control requirements also change during the transition into a climb. From the hover, additional power is added in helicopters with counterclockwise main rotor blade rotation, the left pedal requirement increases. As speed increases, directional stability increases, so the need for left pedal decreases. The tail rotor achieves translational thrust due to clean airflow and begins making more anti-torque thrust than is required, especially if the helicopter has an effective vertical fin that also helps with the anti-torque task. These actions require a decrease in anti-torque pedal to maintain heading. A throttle change may be necessary since the power demand from the tail rotor decreases. A governor hides this control change. Crosswind corrections. If the takeoff is made in a crosswind condition, the student may not be aware of the corrections required during the climb unless briefed in advance. In the hover and during the initial portion of the climb, cyclic must be applied toward the wind. And downwind, pedal applied to keep the helicopter heading straight along the ground track. As speed and altitude are gained, the cyclic is used to establish a crab. As the helicopter is placed into a crab, the anti-torque pedal pressure must be decreased from the slip into coordinated or trimmed flight. Failure to correct for the crosswind results in a downwind drift from the specified ground track. After the helicopter has transitioned through effective translational lift, ETL, the student should begin to crab the helicopter, trim, improving the climb performance. Once the desired or required climb airspeed is attained, the cyclic should be adjusted to maintain the stabilized airspeed attitude. Recommend using slip to align the fuselage with the ground track below approximately 50 feet, and trim the helicopter above 50 feet. traffic, the student may concentrate so completely on achieving the stated objectives that conflicting traffic and obstructions, such as towers and power lines, go unnoticed. Instructing students to look well ahead of the helicopter and to scan for traffic not only helps their awareness of other traffic, but also helps improve attitude control. Hovering, learning to hover can be a frustrating experience for some students as it may take a few flights to learn the maneuver. Instructors should emphasize that the student should relax. Hovering is very difficult at first, but it does work and its importance cannot be overemphasized. Vertical takeoff to a hover and hovering prior to ascending to a hover, teach the student to always check for unreleased tie-downs or restrictions to the freedom of the landing gear. Pilots should always take off to a hover slowly to avoid dynamic rollover accidents from hung landing gear. A slow takeoff also gives the pilot more time to adjust for the translating tendency, making the takeoff smoother and more controlled. Explain to the student that a vertical takeoff to a hover involves flying the helicopter from the ground vertically to a landing gear height of 2 to 4 feet, while maintaining a constant heading. Demonstrate various hovering heights and allow the student to see how a hover at each height appears. Figure 10-4, once the desired landing gear height is achieved, the helicopter should remain nearly motionless over a reference point at a constant altitude and on a constant heading. The maneuver requires a high degree of concentration and coordination. Instructional points prior to any takeoff or maneuver: have the student ensure the area is clear of other traffic, persons, equipment, or obstacles. This can be accomplished by instilling the habit of clearing the helicopter to the left, right, and overhead prior to performing any maneuver. One additional instructional point to make is to teach the student to assess the helicopter control response prior to each flight. Have the student get the helicopter light on the skid/gear and ensure the helicopter ascends to a hover in a nearly level attitude. Ensure that you have enough cyclic control to continue. Once at a 3-foot hover, ensure the helicopter remains nearly level. Point out to the student what a normal hover attitude looks like. If things do not feel or look right, slowly lower the collective and land the helicopter. Attempt to determine why the helicopter is responding in such a way. Adjustment or reduction of load may be necessary. To begin the maneuver, head the helicopter into the wind, if possible. Place the cyclic in the neutral position with the collective in the fold-down position. Increase the throttle smoothly to obtain and maintain proper revolutions per minute, RPM, then slowly raise the collective. Emphasize a smooth, continuous movement, coordinating the throttle to maintain proper RPM. As the collective is increased, the helicopter becomes light on the landing gear, and torque tends to cause the nose to swing or yaw to the right unless sufficient left anti-torque pedal is used to maintain heading. On helicopters with a clockwise main rotor system, the yaw is to the left and right pedal must be applied. As the helicopter becomes light on the landing gear, cyclic pitch control adjustments are necessary to maintain a level attitude. Unless the helicopter design compensates, translating tendency requires constant left cyclic in helicopters with counterclockwise rotating main rotor blades. Many helicopters are designed to hover in a left landing gear low attitude to correct for right drift. Note, when the term level attitude is used during hovering flight, it is in reference to the helicopter remaining stationary without excessive tilt of the fuselage. Each helicopter tends to hover at some attitude that may not be exactly level or parallel with the surface. Translating tendency, winds, and weight and balance all contribute to the fuselage hanging at some off angle to the surface. When the tail rotor is under the plane of the main rotor disc, the fuselage is titled to stop the travel induced by the lateral tail rotor thrust counteracting the rotor torque. When the manufacturer designs the helicopter with an elevated tail rotor, which places the anti-torque in the same plane as the main rotor torque, the fuselage tilt is much less in calm wind conditions. If enough wind is blowing from the opposite direction, the helicopter deck or cabin floor may be level or parallel to the surface, as the cross wind pushes on the side of the fuselage. However, if the wind is blowing from the other side, the deck tilt angle is increased because the rotor must develop sufficient thrust to counteract the tail rotor thrust and the crosswind to maintain position over the surface. If the helicopter only has a single, lightweight pilot aboard, the fore and aft deck or cabin floor angle is probably pitched nose up compared to having two heavy pilots up front with no other loading. Depending on the helicopter, unloading one person can result in a 12% change in gross weight and a corresponding change in pitch. Helicopters usually hover in a normal attitude for that helicopter in that wind condition under that load condition. The student should be taught what the normal attitude for hovering is for the particular helicopter that they are flying. When airborne, at a hover, anti-torque pedals are used to maintain heading and directional control while application of collective ensures continuous vertical ascent to the normal hovering altitude. When hovering altitude is reached, use the throttle and collective to control altitude, the cyclic to maintain a stationary hover, and the anti-torque pedals to maintain heading. Initially, the student will probably overcontrol the helicopter. Excessive movement of any flight control requires a change in the other flight controls. For example, if the helicopter drifts to one side while hovering, a student naturally moves the cyclic in the opposite direction. When this is done, part of the vertical thrust is diverted, resulting in a loss of altitude. To maintain altitude, the student must increase the collective. This increases drag on the blades and tends to slow them. To counteract the drag and maintain RPM, the throttle needs to be increased. Because torque increases, the student must add more pedal pressure to maintain the heading. This can easily lead to overcontrolling the helicopter. However, as the student's level of proficiency increases, problems associated with overcontrolling decrease. To maintain a hover over a point, have the student look for minute changes in the helicopter's attitude and altitude by checking the rotor disc changes against the horizon. When these changes are noticed, the student should make the necessary control inputs before the helicopter starts to move from the point. To detect small variations in altitude or position, the student's main area of visual attention needs to be some distance from the aircraft, using various points on the helicopter or the tip path plane as a reference. Looking too close or looking down leads to overcontrolling. Obviously, in order to remain over a certain point, the student should know where the point is, but his or her attention should not be focused there. Note, helicopter pilots tend to use their peripheral vision more than most pilots. At some distance out in front of the helicopter, the horizon is used for attitude control. Peripheral vision is mainly used close in, near the helicopter, enabling the helicopter pilot to discern the clues of movement from a point, stationary reference. At some point during pilot training, many pilots learn to view the horizon with their peripheral vision and view the landing area with their center vision. Inexperienced students that attempt this at the beginning of their training tend to concentrate only on their intended landing area, tunnel vision. They pay little or no attention to the clues of movement close to the helicopter or their attitude on the horizon. This can lead to loss of control. After a student gains experience, he or she develops a certain feel for the helicopter. The student feels and sees small deviations, so corrections can be made before the helicopter actually moves. A certain relaxed looseness develops, and controlling the helicopter becomes second nature, rather than a mechanical response. Figure 10.5, common student difficulties. Failure to position controls properly. The beginning student rarely knows how to position the controls, so the helicopter lifts off the ground in a level attitude with no tendency to turn. Have the student check the tip path plane of the rotor before raising the collective, looking forward and to each side to see that it is level. Visualizing attitude. The problems of visualizing attitude in the early stages of training can be compounded in hovering flight by looking at a point that is too close to the helicopter. This is a natural tendency when trying to stay over a spot. The student should pick a point well in front of the helicopter, so the horizon is within normal peripheral vision. This makes it easier to perceive the helicopter's attitude while keeping the exact position in view. Overcontrolling. The natural tendency to overcontrol is accentuated by the responsiveness of the helicopter and the student's eagerness to get back over the takeoff spot immediately. While the ultimate objective in hovering is to stay exactly over a spot, the problem of overcontrolling can be alleviated by simply having the student stay within a general area, with the stated objective of gently stopping any drift that develops. Note, remind the student of Newton's first law of motion. An object in motion stays in motion with the same speed and in the same direction unless acted upon by an unbalanced force. This is often referred to as the law of inertia. The student can get ahead of the helicopter and make control inputs before the helicopter has had time to completely respond to any inputs. This is the normal progression of the student gaining experience and getting the feel of the helicopter. RPM control. In the initial attempts at hovering, the student usually does not check RPM and make the necessary corrections. On helicopters equipped with a governor or correlator, RPM control is considerably easier. Periodically call attention to the RPM, and point out that changes in engine RPM can also be heard. Coordination. It is not uncommon for a student, particularly a student transitioning from airplanes, to attempt to gain altitude by applying rearward cyclic pressure, or attempt to turn by using lateral cyclic. To correct this tendency, many instructors operate one or two of the controls while allowing the student to concentrate on the reaction produced by the remaining control. For example, the instructor can operate the pedals and collective while the student experiments with the reactions produced by cyclic inputs. Tension is the natural result of a student's efforts to perform satisfactorily. The initial stage of training requires a great deal of patience on the part of the instructor and a lot of positive reinforcement and encouragement for the student. When tension builds to a point where the student is incapable of performing with an acceptable degree of proficiency, the instructor should take over and allow the student to relax for several moments. Usually, It is best to land and talk over the problems and to ensure neither the student nor instructor compares the student's performance with the instructor's performance. After encouragement and constructive criticism, another takeoff can be performed. Hovering height. Many beginning students have a tendency to hover too high or too low. Hovering too high can create a hazardous flight condition, while hovering too low creates a risk of touching the ground with lateral movement and possible dynamic. Rollover. Abrupt aft cyclic movement can also lead to the tail guard / stinger striking the ground and, in worst cases, the tail rotor. To help avoid this problem, continually reinforce what the correct height should look like and continuously remind the student that a good scan helps prevent unwanted altitude changes. Hovering turn. Demonstrate how a hovering turn is accomplished by manipulating the anti-torque pedals while the helicopter remains over a designated spot at a constant altitude. Figure 10.6, the turn should be made at a low, constant rate through varying degrees of heading. Instructional points. A hovering turn is initiated in either direction by applying anti-torque pedal pressure toward the desired direction. Explain that during a turn to the left, more power is needed because application of left pedal increases the pitch angle of the tail rotor, which, in turn, requires additional power from the engine. A turn to the right requires less power. On helicopters with a clockwise rotating main rotor, right pedal increases the pitch angle and, therefore, requires more power. As the turn begins, use the cyclic as necessary, usually into the wind, to keep the helicopter over the desired spot. Figure 10.7, to continue the turn, additional pedal pressure is required as the helicopter turns to the crosswind position. This is because the wind is striking the tail surface and the tail rotor area, making it more difficult for the tail to turn into the wind. As pedal pressures increase due to crosswind forces, additional cyclic pressure into the wind is required to maintain position. Use the collective with the throttle to maintain a constant altitude and RPM. After the 90 degrees portion of turn, pedal pressure is decreased slightly to maintain the same rate of turn. Approaching the 180 degrees, downwind, portion, opposite pedal pressure must be anticipated due to tail movement from an upwind position to a downwind position. At this point, the rate of turn has a tendency to increase at a rapid rate due to the weather vaning tendencies of the tail surfaces. Because of the tailwind condition, hold rearward cyclic pressure to keep the helicopter over the same spot. Note, the horizontal stabilizer can increase the difficulty of hovering with a strong tailwind. Depending on the specific design and mounting of the stabilizer, a tailwind may tend to lift the tail, requiring more aft cyclic, or lower the tail boom, decreasing the amount of cyclic needed into the wind to hold your position. The student needs to understand the stabilizer's response to tailwind conditions so as to anticipate control movements required. Because of the helicopter's tendency to weather vane, maintaining the same rate of turn from the 180 degrees position actually requires some pedal pressure opposite the direction of turn. If opposite pedal pressure is not applied, the helicopter tends to turn at a faster rate. The amount of pedal pressure and cyclic deflection throughout the turn depends on the wind velocity. As the turn finishes on the upwind heading, apply opposite pedal pressure to stop the turn. Gradually apply forward cyclic pressure to keep the helicopter from drifting. Control pressures and direction of application change continuously throughout the turn. The most dramatic change is the pedal pressure, and corresponding power requirement, necessary to control the rate of turn as the helicopter moves through the downwind portion of the maneuver. The instructor can have the student make turns in either directions. However, in a high wind condition, the tail rotor may not be able to produce enough thrust, which means the student will not be able to control a turn to the right in a counterclockwise rotor system. Therefore, if control is ever questionable, have the student first attempt to make a 90-degree turn to the left. If there is sufficient tail rotor thrust to turn the helicopter crosswind in a left turn, a right turn can be successfully controlled. The opposite applies to helicopters with clockwise rotor systems. Hovering turns should be avoided in wind strong enough to preclude sufficient aft cyclic control to maintain the helicopter on the selected surface reference point when headed downwind. Common student difficulties. In addition to the difficulties already discussed in the takeoff to a hover section, there are some difficulties associated specifically with the hovering turn. Improper rate of turn. Until the student has gained some experience in hovering turns, the amount of pedal required for the desired rate of turn is not known. The result is a turn that is either too slow or too fast, often varying rapidly between the two. The first hovering turn should be practiced in calm or light winds, so a certain pedal input results in a specific rate of turn. Compensating for crosswind. Students usually fail to anticipate the effect of the wind as the helicopter turns. The student must understand that, throughout the turn, the cyclic is displaced into the wind, and is independent of the direction of the turn. Also, pedal input must be increased as the turn approaches the crosswind position, then decreased as the downwind position is approached. Passing the downwind position, the student should anticipate an increase in the rate of turn as a result of the wind force. Coordination before attempting hovering turns, the instructor should explain and demonstrate the effects of pedal input. For example, explain how a left pedal input causes a right drifting tendency, which must be compensated for by using left side cyclic. Even more noticeable is the effect on engine RPM. Left pedal input causes a decrease in RPM and right pedal input causes an increase. As the student gains an understanding of these effects, the tendency to overcontrol the anti-torque pedals should diminish. Hovering forward. Forward hovering should be accomplished at hovering altitude, and at a speed no faster than a brisk walk with heading remaining constant. The forward track should be defined by markings on the ground or by the alignment of two reference points. Figure 10.8, instructional points instruct students on the importance of maintaining a landing gear height high enough to allow adequate ground clearance before hovering in any direction. Stress to the student that the risk of dynamic rollover is greatest during any hovering maneuver. This also stresses the importance of keeping the landing gear aligned with the direction of travel. Apply forward cyclic to start the forward motion, then release some cyclic pressure to prevent the helicopter from accelerating. Hold enough forward cyclic pressure to keep forward motion no faster than a brisk walk. Any speed higher than this requires a higher landing gear height to allow adequate ground clearance for the tail landing gear when bringing a helicopter to a stop using rearward cyclic. As the helicopter begins to move forward and lift is diverted, add a little power to compensate for the loss of lift. Throughout the maneuver, maintain a constant ground speed and path over the ground with the cyclic, a constant heading with the anti-torque pedals, altitude with the collective, and the proper RPM with the throttle. To stop the forward movement, apply rearward cyclic pressure so that the helicopter glides to a halt at a hover, taking care not to lower the tail rotor into the ground. As forward motion stops, return the cyclic to the neutral position to prevent rearward movement. Forward movement can also be stopped by simply applying rearward pressure to level the helicopter and let it drift to a stop. Common student difficulties: altitude control. The student may not understand that an airspeed of about 5 knots requires the most power to maintain altitude as ground effect diminishes and translational lift has not begun to help. As the helicopter begins to move forward in a calm wind, it also tends to sink. The student may think this is caused by too much forward cyclic, and the resulting correction causes a helicopter to stop. Point out that a slight amount of increased collective is required as forward motion starts. This usually alleviates the problem. Note, moving forward requires forward thrust, whereas at a stationary hover, only enough thrust is needed to overcome the wind. Begin a forward hover by diverting some lift to thrust. If that lift is not restored, the hovering altitude decreases. The more lift diverted to thrust, the lower the hover altitude, or the more collective must be increased, with the power increase sufficient to maintain RPM with more anti-torque needed as well. Sideward drift to the side of the planned ground track can be the result of concentration on trying to maintain the heading and altitude. If the ground track is being maintained by reference to a line on the ground, the student may be looking too close to the helicopter and may not notice changes in the altitude. If the student has trouble maintaining the specified ground track, refocus attention to reference points that are farther away from the helicopter. Hovering sideward. Sideward flight begins in a hover and is performed at a constant heading, altitude, and airspeed. Instructional points explain to the student that the risk of dynamic rollover is highest during sideward hovering maneuvers. Maintain adequate landing gear height. Also ensure that sufficient clearance exists for the expected and possible path of the tail rotor for sideward hovering. Before starting sideward flight, make sure the student clears the area. This may require some clearing turns. Then have the student pick two points of reference in a line in the direction of sideward flight to help maintain the proper ground track. These reference points should be kept in line throughout the maneuver. Figure 10.9. The maneuver is begun at a normal hovering altitude by applying cyclic toward the side in which the movement is desired. As the movement begins, return the cyclic toward the neutral position to keep the ground speed low. Throughout the maneuver, maintain a constant ground speed and ground track with cyclic. Maintain heading perpendicular to the ground track in this maneuver, with the anti-torque pedals, and a constant altitude with collective. Use the throttle to maintain the proper operating RPM. As with all maneuvers, instructors should emphasize the importance of scanning. Viewing objects or obstacles while flying sideways can be deceptive. From a distance, trees and wires may look smaller or higher than they actually are. Terrain may look flat until you hover closer to it and quickly realize that it slopes up and you could possibly contact it with either the landing gear or tail rotor. To stop the sideward movement, apply cyclic pressure in the direction opposite to that of movement and hold it until the helicopter stops. As motion stops, return the cyclic to the neutral position to prevent movement in the opposite direction. Applying sufficient opposite cyclic pressure to level the helicopter may also stop sideward movement. The helicopter then drifts to a stop. Common student difficulties: speed control in sideward flight, lateral cyclic input control speed. If the student is looking primarily to the side in an attempt to maintain the track, roll attitude can be difficult to maintain. Scan must be continuous if the correct attitude is to be maintained. The student must continuously check to the side, then look in front to check attitude. This is followed by a check of the RPM, then a look back to the side. Drift can also be an attitude problem. If the student concentrates too much to the side, pitch attitude can deviate from level, resulting in drift from the desired track. Heading: as the helicopter begins to move sideward, the nose tends to weathercock into the direction of flight. Again, this may not be noticed if the student is concentrating his or her attention in the direction of flight. Hovering rearward. Rearward hovering is conducted using reference points ahead of the helicopter to maintain track. Altitude and heading should remain constant, and ground speed should be no faster than a brisk walk. Instructional points before beginning the maneuver: make sure the area behind the helicopter is clear. This is accomplished by making a 90 degrees clearing turn. Choose two reference points in front of, and in line with, the helicopter as if hovering forward. The movement of the helicopter should be such that these points remain in line. Begin the maneuver from a normal hovering altitude by applying rearward pressure on the cyclic. Once the movement has begun, position the cyclic to maintain a low ground speed, no faster than a brisk walk. Throughout the maneuver, maintain constant ground speed and ground track with the cyclic, a constant heading with the anti-torque pedals, constant altitude with the collective, and the proper RPM with the throttle. When hovering backwards, the helicopter is tilted so the tail is low to the ground. Therefore, maintain a slightly higher than normal hovering altitude. To stop the rearward movement, apply forward cyclic and hold it until the helicopter stops. As the motion stops, return the cyclic to the neutral position. Also, as in the case of forward flight and sideward flight, use opposite cyclic to level the helicopter and let it drift to a stop. Common student difficulties: speed control. The student may not realize that it takes a steeper pitch attitude to start the helicopter moving than it does to continue motion at a steady speed. If the nose is not moved down slightly as the desired rearward speed is attained, the helicopter continues to accelerate. Note: acceleration and force are vectors. In Newton's second law of motion, the direction of the force vector is the same as the direction of the acceleration vector. In other words, an object with a certain velocity maintains that velocity unless a force acts on it to cause an acceleration, that is, a change in the velocity. If the pitch attitude is not returned to a neutral, non-accelerating or decelerating attitude, stabilization of the speed and velocity cannot occur. Heading: the faster the helicopter travels rearward, the greater the tendency for the nose of the helicopter to swing around toward the direction of flight. With the tail directly into the relative wind, there is little tendency for it to weather vane, but if the relative wind is a little bit on one side, the tail tends to continue to the downwind side. The resulting heading correction requires a fairly large pedal input, which may cause an overshoot to the other side, and the process must be repeated with opposite pedal input. Speed must be reduced to regain control. During preflight, show the student which surface areas of the helicopter are affected by relative wind from different directions, what is causing the weather vane. Discuss how you need to overcome the effects of the wind during different directions of hover, forward, rearward, sideward. Landing from a hover: the helicopter is stabilized in a hover directly over the intended landing spot, then gently lowered onto the ground. It should not drift in any direction at the point of touchdown. The instructor should remind the student pilot of the flight control changes that must occur during this seemingly simple task. As the helicopter begins to settle onto the surface, all of the flight controls must be manipulated simultaneously and in coordination to achieve a smooth landing. When choosing a landing area for the student to practice landing from a hover, instructors should keep in mind that certain conditions usually dictate a landing directly to the ground with little or no hover. For example, dust, sand, or snow landings are very difficult, and should not be attempted until the student has shown considerable proficiency with takeoffs and landings. These types of landings are discussed in Chapter 12, Helicopter Emergencies. Landing in a grassy field or in a spot with puddles of water can also cause problems for flight students. The grass or water motion presents a false picture of helicopter movement to the new pilot and causes them to incorrectly respond when attempting to land. Instructional points: the student should be instructed to look outside and ahead of the helicopter. Focusing on the ground through the chin bubble leads to overcontrolling and makes it difficult to land on the desired spot. Always keep the RPM within limits. This allows for quick transition back to hover if the landing is not suitable. Never allow the helicopter to settle on the ground, which might occur if the throttle is reduced below the RPM limits. To prevent overspeed, the correct technique requires simultaneously lowering the collective and reducing the throttle. Do not abruptly lower the collective once ground contact is made. First, ensure the ground is sufficiently stable to support the helicopter. This requires a slow and deliberate lowering of the collective. The cyclic may be moved in a small circular motion to determine that the helicopter is firmly on the ground before lowering the collective fully. Once the helicopter is firmly on the ground, the collective should be lowered completely. Landing a helicopter requires the same attention as takeoffs to a hover. Point out which skid/gear will contact the surface first and why. What control inputs will be applied to stop sliding, moving forward? Forward or aft cyclic may be required during the landing to maintain the position. How is excessive slope recognized before the tilt is too much to overcome? Common student difficulties: attitude control. The closer the helicopter comes to the ground, the more likely it is for the student to focus on a point almost directly beneath the helicopter. As the helicopter descends, ground effect tends to increase, thereby creating a greater workload for the pilot to maintain coordination of all the flight controls until the helicopter is on the surface. Without proper attitude technique, the student may overcontrol when the helicopter begins to drift, and the situation may go from bad to worse. The student must be taught to look far in front of the helicopter and then gently lower it until the touchdown is felt, not seen. Remind the student that most likely one side of the landing gear contacts the surface before the other due to winds or translating tendency. Due to loading and winds, the front or the rear of the landing gear may touch down first depending on the hovering attitude of that helicopter. In any event, as the landing gear first touches down, cyclic and pedal corrections are continually necessary to maintain heading and position until the remainder of the landing gear is firmly on the surface. RPM control during the landing. Rotor RPM tends to increase due to the effects of increased ground effect and decreased collective pitch. During touchdown, for those helicopters not equipped with a governor, the throttle may need to be reduced to avoid an overspeed. Taxi. Once a student has learned the basic skills required to hover the helicopter, those skills translate into the practical application of taxiing the helicopter. In order to accomplish this task, the student should understand the terms used and the limitations placed on each action and the basic information and safety involved in selecting hover altitudes and speeds derived from the HV chart. Hover taxi. The term hover taxi is used to describe a helicopter movement conducted above the surface and in ground effect at airspeeds less than approximately 20 knots. Figure 10:10, the actual height may vary, and some helicopters may hover taxi above 25 feet above ground level, AGL, to reduce ground effect turbulence or provide clearance for cargo sling loads. Air taxi. The term air taxi describes helicopter movement conducted above the surface, but normally not above 100 feet AGL. Figure 10:11, the helicopter may proceed either via hover taxi or flight at speeds more than 20 knots. The pilot is solely responsible for selecting a safe airspeed/altitude for the operation being conducted. Surface/ground taxi. Taxi, surface taxi, or ground taxi is the movement of an aircraft under its own power, actually in physical contact with the surface of an airport. It also describes the surface movement of helicopters equipped with wheels. Figure 10:12, ground taxi can form the basis for a running takeoff used by older, underpowered helicopters. Ground taxi creates less downwash, since less thrust is required to slide the skids than to support the entire weight of the helicopter. Wheel taxi is very efficient. Water or ski taxi is between those two extremes in terms of power required. Surface taxi includes ground contact taxiing with wheels, floats, skis, or skids. Ground contact requires less power than hover taxiing and produces less rotor wash, depending on the surface friction. If skis are stuck to the surface, it may take some power to break them loose. Surface taxi also provides an alternative method of taking off in white or brownout conditions by blowing the obstructing material behind the helicopter as some airspeed is reached, and certainly by translational lift speed. Caution should be observed to prevent the landing gear from being stuck to the surface or striking something on the takeoff surface, leading to dynamic rollover. Surface taxi is not a common or preferred maneuver, but it has been used in certain situations, generally in much older, underpowered helicopters. Instructional points for hover taxi, air taxi, and taxi: have the student review the Aeronautical Information Manual, AIM, paragraphs April 3, 2017 and 7513C. Prior to air taxi demonstration and practice, the instructor should review the HV chart and have the student assist in planning or developing a safe air taxi profile of airspeeds versus altitudes. Since the AIM gives 100 AGL as the upper limit, the instructor should find 100°A.G.L. on the chart and determine minimum and maximum airspeeds for the maneuver, remembering the helicopter requires power to decelerate and come to hover without translational lift and thrust. Discuss with the student the HV chart to determine the safest flight profile that should be used during any taxi operation. The advantages of ground or surface taxi for skid-equipped helicopters should be discussed so the student will understand some criteria for deciding on their own when ground taxi is safer and the recommended maneuver for that occasion. Discuss with the student the HV chart to determine the safest flight profile that should be used during any taxi operation. Ground reference maneuvers. Ground reference maneuvers are training exercises that can be used to develop coordination, division of attention, and situational awareness. The maneuvers themselves are not evaluated during the practical test, but the skills developed by accomplishing them are evaluated during the conduct of other tasks. By performing ground reference maneuvers, a student develops a better understanding of the effects of wind drift and how to compensate for winds from different directions during flight. Rectangular course. The rectangular course helps the student develop recognition of drift toward or away from a line parallel to the intended ground track. Figure 10-13, it is important that he or she understand the effects of the wind and how to compensate for it. The rectangular course also simulates an airport traffic pattern, as well as many of the maneuvers a helicopter is tasked with performing, such as tracking an event for photographic purposes, aerial surveys, and observation duties. This is an opportunity to point out to the student what each segment of a traffic pattern represents: upwind, crosswind, downwind, base, and final leg. For this maneuver, pick a square or rectangular field, or an area bounded on four sides by section lines or roads, where the sides are approximately a mile in length. The area selected should be well away from other air traffic. Fly the maneuver between 500 and 800 feet AGL, which is the altitude normally required for an airport traffic pattern to avoid the flow of fixed-wing traffic. If the student finds it difficult to maintain a proper ground track at that higher altitude, adjust the altitude for better ground reference until the student feels more comfortable and is able to grasp the concept better. The helicopter should be flown parallel to and at a uniform distance from the field boundaries, not above the boundaries. Demonstrate that by flying directly above the edges of the field, there are no usable reference points to start and complete the turns. In addition, the closer the track of the helicopter is to the field boundaries, the steeper the bank necessary at the turning points. The student should understand that when trying to fly a straight line and maintain a specific heading, the helicopter should always be kept in trim with the anti-torque pedals and the pilot should crab into the wind, with the cyclic, to stay on the proper ground track. The concept of crabbing can be difficult for the student to understand when first learning how to fly a traffic pattern. The instructor should show the student what happens when you try to fly a straight line with a crosswind, and point out how far off course the wind can take you. Keeping the helicopter in trim and keeping the helicopter straight are done with two different flight controls, and the instructor should ensure the student understands the effects of crabbing to allow for wind drift. Since the helicopter is not headed exactly parallel to the rectangle course, turns at the corners of the rectangle may be more or less than 90 degrees with a shallower or steeper bank angle to hold the correct distance from the rectangle. The rectangular course requires the student to adjust for winds from each quadrant. Also ensure that the cyclic trim, if installed, is properly trimmed in order to decrease the pressures on the pilot. Prior to takeoff, the instructor should discuss with the student how the wind velocity aloft are greater than those reported on the ground and may possibly shift. If the winds are known, the instructor can have the student calculate the amount of wind crab necessary to track the boundaries. This allows the student more insight to the use of crab angles to track courses. Not enough emphasis can be placed on always knowing which way the winds are coming from and how to be vigilant in seeking ground cues for hints of a wind change. S-turn. The S-turn is another training maneuver that requires a student to compensate for winds. Figure 10-14, this maneuver requires turns to the left and right. Choose a road, a fence, or a railroad for a reference line. Regardless of what is used, it should be straight for a considerable distance and should extend as close to perpendicular to the wind as possible. An S-turn is a pattern of two half circles of equal size on opposite sides of a reference line. A standard radius for S-turns cannot be specified, since the radius depends on the airspeed of the helicopter, the velocity of the wind, and the initial bank chosen for entry. The maneuver should be performed at a constant altitude. While S-turns may be started at any point, it may be beneficial during early training to start the maneuver with the helicopter flying into the wind. Turns around a point. This training maneuver requires the student to fly constant radius turns around a pre-selected point on the ground, using a bank of approximately 30 degrees while maintaining both a constant altitude and the same distance from the point throughout the maneuver. Figure 10-15, the objective, as in other ground reference maneuvers, is to develop the ability to control the helicopter subconsciously while dividing attention between the flight path, how the winds are affecting the turn, and ground references, while still watching for other air traffic in the vicinity. A reason to perform turns around a point, other than for proficiency, is high reconnaissance, photography, survey, and search and rescue. Great care should be exercised to remain clear of obstructions and other low-level traffic during ground reference maneuvering. The factors and principles of drift correction that are involved in S-turns are also applicable in this maneuver. As in other ground track maneuvers, a constant radius around a point requires the student constantly to change the angle of bank and make numerous control changes to compensate for the wind. The point selected for turns around a point should be prominent and easily distinguishable, yet small enough to present a precise reference. Common student difficulties: failure to plan properly. Ensure the student plans properly for the ground reference maneuver to be flown. That should include checking the current and forecasted weather. Students often fail to take the wind into consideration when setting up to perform a maneuver. Point out that winds can be determined by observing ground cues, such as flags, ripples on a pond, or smoke. The student should be able to explain, prior to takeoff, how to maintain desired ground track while in flight. Coordination: remind the student that each control input causes something else to change. Remember, a beginning student may have difficulty not only in accomplishing the actions in the proper sequence, but also in compensating for control inputs. Talk the student through each maneuver to remove any doubt about what is to be accomplished, as well as how and when it is done. Division of attention: when performing a ground reference maneuver, students have a tendency to focus attention outside the helicopter, excluding cockpit or instrument checks, or focus entirely on the interior checks to the exclusion of outside references. If the student focuses all attention outside the helicopter, a good way to refocus attention inside is to pose a question, such as what is the helicopter's altitude? Or what is the airspeed? If the student's attention is focused inside the helicopter, have the student clear the helicopter or describe what he or she is using as an outside reference. Attitude: remember that the forward seating position and the excellent visibility in most helicopters may make it difficult for a student to visualize the attitude of the helicopter. It is important for the instructor to provide all the assistance possible to ensure the student can determine an attitude by some visual reference, such as a cross member or point on the windscreen. A water-soluble marker can be used to place dots on the bubble representing the sight picture of the horizon at a given airspeed. Instructors usually develop different methods of teaching attitude references. Scan: it is common for a student to concentrate on one factor to the exclusion of others. Due to poor scanning technique, the student may select a ground reference that fails to offer a suitable emergency landing area within gliding distance. Instructor tips: a student will attempt to imitate instructor actions. Do not take shortcuts. Instill safety from the first day. Insist the student clear the helicopter in all directions prior to performing any maneuver. Stay close to the controls at all times, but especially during the hover. Be prepared for both the expected and the unexpected. Students transitioning to helicopters from airplanes may have air sense, but remember, they are still students. Students do the unexpected, especially students who are transitioning from airplanes to helicopters, and should be closely supervised. There are many negative transfers of training from airplanes to helicopters. In instances of stress, the airplane pilot can be expected to revert to first learned behaviors, which can have deadly consequences in helicopters. The differences should be well explained and briefed before each flight. When a student encounters difficulty in mastering an objective, find a means of allowing some degree of success. For example, when practicing climbing and descending turns, rather than have the student attempt the entire maneuver, try having him or her practice climbing and descending. When no difficulty is experienced, add the turn, continue until the entire maneuver is completed. Should difficulty still occur, back up a step and work on climb and level off and descent and level off rather than cause too much frustration. Sometimes instructors make the mistake of continuing to have students attempt a maneuver when performance is deteriorating. It is better to quit at that point and go back to something the student can do well to rebuild his or her confidence. Remember, 3 or 4 iterations of each task is sufficient training. After that point, the instructor is probably wasting the student's time and money. Fatigue occurs, and training ends. More pre-flight briefing and ground school may be needed. Beginning with the first flight, students learn to pre-plan the performance parameters for the entire flight. 1. Power required to hover, OGAE. 2. Total power available, 3. Power available at the highest altitude and temperature for the day. 4. Hover requirements at the highest altitude and temperature for that day. It is essential to discuss the meeting of these parameter values and to ensure that the student understands the limitations imposed by these values, even if the RFM does not state them as limits. Figure 10-16. Chapter summary: this chapter presented some training techniques and instructional points an instructor can use to teach hovering flight and basic flight maneuvers. Common difficulties students encounter when attempting to perform hovering flight and basic maneuvers were also discussed.